Hey, Pastor Harold here from Abundant Life Forsyth Church. I want to say thank you for tuning in today via Facebook, YouTube, whatever you may be doing to watch this service. I believe God has a word for you. I hope you'll watch the entire video today and may God touch you through it. But look, if you want more than just a video, you want a personal experience, you want to feel the presence of God, I want to invite you out to Abundant Life Forsyth, 962 Juliet Road. Look, we have a lot of stuff happening here. Sunday mornings at 9 a.m., we have My Groups, which covers a variety of age groups, women's ministry, men's ministry, all these things are happening. Also, Sunday mornings at 10:30 is when our worship service starts, followed by the preaching of the word. Then Tuesday nights at 6 p.m., we got prayer meeting. Wednesday nights, we got a Bible study slash preaching that happens at 7 p.m. with youth ministry, children's ministry once again. And now we also offer Celebrate Recovery at 7 p.m. on Thursday night. Look, there's a lot happening right here in Forsyth, Georgia, and I believe God gave you this video today to help you get connected. So I want to encourage you. I want to invite you to come out and be a part of what's happening. I personally want to meet you. If you'll come down here and you'll let me know that you watch this video, I have a special gift just for you. Hey, God bless you. I appreciate you watching this, and I hope to see you soon. Sunday week. Is that how you say it? Sunday week. I'm trying to figure out the date right quick. The 15th. No, the 22nd. 22nd. What am I? All right. It's 22nd. That's between me and her. 22nd, two Sundays from now. We will be starting back up our classes, or my group classes. And so Faith Foundations will continue to keep going. In the conference room there, you need to sign up for that. Elder Jim Worley will be teaching that. Miss Shay Singletary, raise your hand, Shay. She's going to be teaching the armor of God. Now, this is a women's class, right? All right. And then Pastor Scott and Pastor Jennifer are going to be teaching a class called The Four Laws of Love. Is that right? And that's going to be for couples, all right? That's for married couples and couples that may be intending to get married, all right? So y'all come out for that. Sign up for these classes. That way we'll know where to put you on that day, which is November the 22nd. Amen. Amen. And one more thing I just want to announce. I know I keep saying it, but and believe me, I don't even want to say it anymore. But continue to keep my family in prayers. I lost another cousin yesterday. So that makes 14 now. So just keep everybody in prayer. Amen? Amen. But God is still sitting on the throne. Amen. That's right. All right. I'm trying to think of some way to do something right here, but when I think about it, I'll do it. How about that? All right. We're going to be tonight. We're going to be talking about, we've been on a series called In Christ. And tonight, I want to continue with that, and we're going to be doing the family in Christ tonight. And this is going to be hitting husbands, wives, kids, the whole nine yards. And so I want you to hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying tonight, because if you want a happy house, all right, if you'll do what I'm fixing to teach you tonight, you'll have a happy home, all right? Now, how do I know that? Because I just spoke it into the atmosphere, and it's up to you to receive it. Amen. Amen. So we're going to be in Ephesians chapter 5 tonight. We're going to start in verse 21. Now, I'm just going to read verse 21 because I'm going to go through the whole rest of the chapter, a little bit in chapter 6 and throughout. So I'm not going to read it all at one time. So I'm just going to read that one verse, and we're going to pray, and we're going to get started. All right. Verse 21 says, submitting to one another in the fear of God. Somebody shout, submitting. Precious Lamb of God, we thank you tonight. We're able to come into your house and worship you. Now, Father, as we have lifted up a praise on our lips and we have lifted our hands to heaven, God, we have submitted ourselves to you and asked you to come into this place and have an encounter with us.
Now, Father, we thank you for your Holy Spirit, Father, for being here tonight with us. I pray tonight, God, that you would touch the hearts of every person under the sound of my voice, God. I pray tonight that revelation would come forth from the wisdom and of the Holy Spirit, Father. I pray tonight that the pages of the Scripture would be illuminated into the people's eyesight, God. I pray tonight, Lord, that we would leave here hungry and thirstier than we never have been for you before, Lord. I pray tonight, God, that families and households would be restored, restoration would take place. I pray for a deeper love than they've ever had before, God. I pray tonight that we would put on the love of Christ. Now, Father, I thank you, God, for allowing me to have this time with your people. I ask you tonight to anoint my lips to preach and teach your word. Anoint the ears to hear it and the hearts to receive it. It's in the mighty name of Jesus that I ask these things. Amen. Amen. Somebody give God one more hand clap of praise right there. Hallelujah. Look, turn around and tell somebody you're glad to see him tonight. Handshake, fist bump, whatever you're doing. Just do something. Amen. Amen. All right. Can somebody tell me what date we're going to start my group classes on? Oh, geez, you're supposed to raise your hand. I was going to try to give somebody a free gift card, but it ain't happening. Too late for that now. I got to think of something else in a minute. Are you hot? Y'all hot? Praise the Lord. Well, look here. I'm trying to just get y'all in a mood because I'm probably going to be stepping on some toes in a minute. I'm just trying to get y'all in a happy mood. But the secret to a happy family is following God's instructions. All right? I don't know how many of you in here were together before you came to Christ. And there was probably times in your life you thought you was having a good, fun relationship. But I'm telling you, it was a temporary thing. But if you will follow the instruction that God has given us, we will have a happy life and a happy marriage together. So have you ever heard the saying, that's a match made in heaven? You ever heard somebody say that? Man, that's just a match made in heaven. Well, you know, we say that and we don't think about it, but really and truly, there's truth to that, isn't there? Because in Genesis chapter 2, that's what God decreed. He put the man and woman together. However, when you insert the falling state of mankind or a fallen human being into anything, even into something that God has instituted, you got a possibility of an operator error. Amen. Because why? Because we're humans. There was a poll that showed that 35% of all marriages end up in divorce among unbelievers. The same study showed that born again Christians claiming to be followers of Jesus Christ, 35% of all marriages end in divorce. That's a problem. When the Christians are ending in the same as the world. So apparently we are not doing what God has given us the instruction to do. And that's what I want to touch base on tonight. So marriages for followers of Jesus Christ should be stronger. They should last longer than marriages of the people outside in the world. Because Christ has given us the instruction. He's given us the booklet, so to speak, the manual to how to have a happy marriage. So in the text, the Apostle Paul gives us an instruction on how to do this. And the secret to it is just basically following instruction. How many of you got in trouble in school a lot? Right there on the front row. Go ahead. All the time. Why? Because you probably didn't follow instruction. When you followed instruction, you were less likely to get in trouble. How many of you youth in here get in trouble at home a lot? Chris, I'm going to let you and Brent and Tiny Mo be youth tonight. I'm glad that none of the youth in here get in trouble but Nick. So, Nick, just follow instructions, brother. But we do that because we fail to follow instructions. So, Paul gives one simple instruction to start with in verse 21. He says, submit to one another. Now, this is just a fundamental Christian principle that we all have to have a basic understanding of. So verse 21 says, and further submit to one another. I'm reading in the NLT tonight. and further submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. That is a principle, a basic principle. The problem is that one that we largely misunderstand, both in the world and in the church. It's misunderstood in cultural, in the world, because they think it only refers to women. Amen. The world thinks of women as being subservient when they hear the word to submit. All right. Now, the interpretation on the part of this is very ridiculous, how the world has changed this thing around, for several reasons. First of all, the word has nothing to do with be subservient. Okay, understand this now. The word submission has nothing to do with forcing someone to do something against their will. All right, that's not submission. There's a commentary, and it said the word that Paul uses here is the middle or passive voice, which indicates that it is something that a person does voluntarily. So submitting then has to be considered worthy of someone's respect. I respect you, so when you tell me to do something or ask me to do something, I submit to you. All right? Does everybody understand that? So because people hold certain positions, we submit to them. We submit to their authority. It's placing yourself under the authority of another who is worthy of that respect. All right? The third reason that that is incorrect of what their interpretation is because it doesn't refer just to women. Men have to submit too. Men have to submit. Children have to submit. All of these have to submit. So men just have to be just as submissive to the wife or to women as the women do to the men. Amen. I figured every woman in here would have said that. But listen to this now. It has to do with our reverence, with respect and honor for Christ. Amen. Hear me now. Paul says we are to be submissive to one another out of reverence for Christ. We do it because Jesus has asked us to do it. We do it because God's word tells us that we should, and we do it because this is what God requires of us to do. Now, C.L. Lewis wrote this right here, but before I get into what he said, I want you to understand something here. 99% of everything you believe was because someone told you. Do you understand that? 99% of what you believe based on somebody that had authority in your life. Kids believe things because the parents tell them things, right? Amen. Amen. I believe there is a place, let's just say, where haven't I been? I believe there's a place of the South Pole. Why do I believe that? Because the scientists tell me there is. I believe there's a solar system. Why? Because scientists tell me that. I'm looking at somebody that's in authority, and I'm saying I take what they say, and I submit to what they say and believe what they're saying. Does that make sense? Now, every statement, listen to me, every historical statement is believed and based on somebody's authoritative word. Do you understand that? We don't just make things up of history. Somehow it has been written, it has been passed on. You take the Spanish-American War. Nobody in this room was there. But we believe it happened because it was written down by people in authority. So submission is somewhat based on authority. All right? It's based on the authority of who? Jesus Christ. He's the Lord of the church, right? So as we are the church, we are to be submissive unto him first and foremost. It's based on the authority of the inherent, infallible word of God. It's based on foundation laid down by the apostles and the things that they taught, which they learned from who? Jesus himself. That's where they got their teaching for. So submission is somewhat universal. Am I losing you, or are you just marinating? All right, we're marinating. So what I mean by that it is universal, it means everybody submits to somebody. Everybody submits to somebody. I'm the pastor of this house, but I still submit because I hold my credentialing through the assemblies of God. So now I submit to the local presbyter. I submit to the district superintendent, the general superintendent, all these I submit to. So as your pastor and you attend here, you submit unto me. Now, you do it because you are in reverence of who God, or in honor of who God has placed over you. Hebrews 13:17 in the New Living Translation says, obey your spiritual leaders and do what they say. Their work is to watch over your souls, and they are accountable to God. Now listen to me right here. When you think I'm getting on to you, it's because I've been held accountable to another standard, to a higher standard, all right? The Bible says that I will actually be judged differently for the things that I teach and say. Now listen to this right here. Give them reason. Somebody say, give them a reason.
Give them a reason.
To do this with joy. Give them a reason to do this with joy and not with sorrow. That would certainly not be for your benefit. If we can't pastor and minister with a sense of joy and we get bogged down with all these things, you will not benefit, because we will not be able to hear from God because we're bogged down with all these things. If you're in leadership and you're in position in a church, then those under you are to submit to you as well. And this continues in the family and in the workplace. Amen. Amen. Submission, though, is voluntarily. You don't have to submit. All right? You can be rebellious. There's a whole other preaching on that. But we must be willing to submit to another's authority. We must be willing to submit to the authority of God's word. And we must be willing to make the decision to follow authority. Now, when we do this, when we submit to the authority that is put over us, we are submitting to God's will. You understand that? How does this play part in the family, though? Now, here's where I'm going with all this. Verse 22, big verse in the whole Bible. For wives, this means submit. Somebody shout, submit.
Submit
your husbands to your husbands as to the Lord. How about that?
Amen.
Don't get mad about it, because look, it's going to turn around in a minute. It's not a very popular concept today. However, there are some things that we have to pay attention to. First, nowhere in the text does Paul say that wives have to obey. He never said obey. He said submit. He says they must submit to their husbands. And remember, the word submit is voluntarily. It's a voluntary submission. So in other words, you are never supposed to force your wives into submitting to you. All right? You understand that? Second, Paul says that wives are to submit to their husbands as to the Lord. Now, in other words, their submission to their husbands is a part of submission to Christ. When you submit to your husband, you're likewise you're submitting unto Christ. Now, there may be some of you in here right now that say, why do I have to submit to him? He's a knucklehead. He don't know how to do things. Why do I got to submit to him? Because nowhere in the scripture does it tell us or give qualifications of who you got to submit to. All right? Paul doesn't say submit to your husbands if he's the best looking man in the world, or if he's got all the money and says all the right things. Paul doesn't say that. He says submit to your husbands as you would submit unto the Lord. He doesn't say submit to your husbands unless you're smarter than him. He doesn't say that. Now listen to me for a minute. Verse 23 says, for a husband is the head of his wife, as Christ is the head of the church. He is the Savior of his body, the church. So what does Paul mean right here? He's saying that the husband is the head of the wife and the Christ is head of the man. The word head in Scripture refers to authority, not a being. Okay? Neither man nor woman is superior to the other in being. Men and women are equal in God's eyes. All right? When God talks about man being the head of the woman, he's not talking about the ability or the worth or their value or anything like that. God is talking about function and order within an organization. So what am I saying there? Every organization has to have a head. There has to be a head to operate in order for it to be effective. All right? There's a structure that God sets. When we can see this in his reference to the church, we'll understand it. Verse 24 says, as the church submits to Christ, so you wives should submit to your husbands in everything. When Paul says that Christ is the head of the church, he's talking about Christ is the leader. All right? He's the leader. So he's your provider, not me. Christ is the provider, and he's your protector. Every organization has to have a leader, and any organization is in trouble if they got too many chiefs and not enough Indians. That was not a racist remark. I'm just going to throw that out there, really. However, there is an advantage when you are up under somebody's authority. The person in authority bears all responsibility. Okay, you understand that? So when you tell somebody to do something, they go, well, it ain't going to work. It don't matter. It don't matter if it ain't going to work. If they're your authority, you submit and you do what they say. And then if it doesn't work, guess who it's on? It's on them. The person that is in authority, therefore, provides protection for you, guidance, and counsel. So this is what the husband's responsibility is for the wife. Do you hear me? We've had a misconception of this throughout our lives. Wives submitting to their husbands is not very popular because our society teaches that women are as good or better than any man. Society teaches that women are to be independent beings, and society teaches that women are to be assertive and should not be submissive to no one. However, when wives submit to their husbands, then they are following the word of God. Then they are being biblical. So ladies, if you are not letting your husband lead your house, you are out of order with the scripture. Therefore, your house may not be blessed because you are not walking according to the word of God. I knew that wasn't going to be happy. But it has nothing to do with being inferior or lacking in self-worth. It has nothing to be being as good or as better as a man. It has to do with being obedient to the word of God. All right. Wives submitting to their husband has to do with trusting him. Do you trust that this man that God has ordained you to be married to, do you trust him with everything? Do you trust God enough to be willing to submit to the man that he gave you? If you do, if you will start submitting, even though you may not agree with everything, if you will start submitting, God will change that man into who he needs to be. But sometimes he can't be shaped into who he needs to be because the house is not in the right order. All right. Let me just get on out of that because ladies, there's more ladies in here than men. So men, what's your responsibility? All right. Husbands, love your wives. So ladies, if you think you've got it rough, I want you to look at what God says about the husband. Verse 25. For husbands, this means love your wives just as Christ loved the church. Now, guys, I'm telling you right now, that's a heavy expectation that Christ just put on us. Because truly, can anybody love someone like Christ loved the church? Think about that for a minute. The love that the husband is to have for his wife is the very love of God himself. All right? The Greek word, I always say it, is the agape love. Agape love is a selfless and unselfish love. It has no end. It has no bounds. It's a giving, sacrificial love. It's the love of the mind and will as well as of the heart. It's not only a love of affection and feelings, but it's a love of will and commitment. Do you understand that? I just feel like I'm losing y'all. I don't know. The same Christ who gave up all his rights and privileges to come to earth did it for our benefit because he loved us that much. The same Christ who established his church and promised that the gates of hell would not prevail came down because he loved us. The same Christ who sent the Holy Ghost to protect God and empower the church came because he loved us. And can anyone love anybody else that much? Above all, the same Christ gave up his life for his church to make her holy and clean, washed by the cleansing of God's word, is what the scripture says. Philippians 2:8 says, he humbled himself in obedience to God and died a criminal's death on a cross. John 15:13 said, there's no greater love than to lay down one's life for one's friend. Jesus gave the last full measure of devotion to his church. He gave his life. And guys, that's what he expects of you. You are to lay down your life for your wife. You write that down, Kenny. That's a spoken word right there. Lay down your life for your wife. Paul goes on to say in verse 28, in the same way husbands ought to love their wives as they love their own bodies. For a man who loves his wife actually shows love for himself. Likewise, husbands actually benefit when they obey by loving their wives as Christ loved the church. He says that when they love their wives, they're actually loving themselves. So look, guys, and I'm not saying anybody in here is doing this. I'm just talking. You would not go around and beat yourself up, would you? So therefore, you would not beat your wife up. You treat your wife like you would treat yourself. So you would not ask her to do anything that you wouldn't do. You understand where I'm saying with that? I hope you getting this tonight. Because it may be a teaching, but I'm telling you, if you implement this in your life will change forever. I'm not saying me and my wife got it all together, but we 98% there. I believe that we have such a good relationship, and we've come a long way. It's been a long time to get there where we're at. A lot of it was me having to change. A lot of it was having to do this, what all this is saying right here. Verse 31 says, as the scripture says, a man leaves his father and mother and is joined to his wife, and the two are united into one. When we are joined together in holy matrimony, we are no longer two separate people. But God joins us together as one. Now, the word joined right here means to cement together. Cement together. To be joined in the closest union possible. To be bound together. To be so totally united that two become one. Therefore, when you truly love your wife as you're supposed to, it's like you just love yourself. Now, I don't know about guys in here, how much you love yourself. But a lot of guys love their self and put their self on a pedestal when you should be putting your wife on that pedestal. So how can two people become one? Paul says in verse 32, this is a great mystery, but it is an illustration of the way Christ and the church are one. Now listen to me, why it's not impossible, right here, that mystery means something that is difficult to comprehend. It is not the way it is meant or understood. In Ephesians here, you got, look, when you start reading the scripture, you need to get you a concordance somehow that you can check the words and understand fully what they mean. Paul uses the term right here to point to a revelation from God. So basically, it's something that one would not know if God had not revealed it to them. That's the mystery he's talking about. It's a revelation of God's word. Now, this seems almost impossible from a human standpoint, but we got to remember, with God, all things are possible. So when we don't understand something, if we ask the Holy Spirit to give us the understanding of it, he can do that. Look, Paul said, I neither got this from man nor from book, but I got it from the Holy Spirit. So look, there's some things that you can't get from man, you can't get the answer from, or from a book. You have to get it from the Holy Spirit. All right? So God revealed this mystery not only so we could understand what happens in marriage, but also what happens in a person's life when they become a Christian. 2 Corinthians 5:17, who knows that? I'm just going to put that in my pocket. You got it? Go ahead. I'll let you have it. You can get this to me after. I'll give you that. All right, give Chase. She's been studying her scriptures. In the NLT, it says, this means that anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. The old life is gone. A new life has begun. So when husbands love their wives, they're loving the Lord the same way that God loved the church. Therefore, in return, we're loving ourselves in such a way because we're following Christ's footsteps. So there's nothing that separates the woman that God has put into our life. Does that make sense? All right. How many of you heard of Promise Keepers? You remember the Promise Keepers that went around for a while? It was a men's meeting organization that went around, and they was going all over, and it just swept across America. And when they would meet like in stadiums. It got so big, and they would go out and basically they focused on keeping their promise to God. That's why it was called Promise Keepers. And so everybody tried to say that these groups were trying to force women to do things, to be submissive, subservient, like I was talking about a while ago, but it's not what it was for. And so they actually started forming, these women would come, or these groups would come and get out before where they was having their meeting and start protesting, trying to get it to shut down. What happened was the wives of all the men that were inside started showing up too. And they started rallying against the protest and saying, "Now you don't understand. My husband has changed because of these promise keepers." Why? Because God's word was coming forth and they were seeing it in their marriages. Beloved, I'm telling you tonight, if we will do the word of God, it will change your whole life. We love our wives because God said so. Not because you just married them. God put this woman in your life, and therefore you are to love her unconditionally. Unconditionally. Men are commanded to love, respect, admire, and care for their wives. Listen to me for a minute. That's not an option. It's a command. It's a command in the Word of God. As a Christian man, your first, listen to me, guys, your first and greatest ministry is to your wife. Christ's first ministry was the church, and he said you are to love your wife as I love the church. She is your first ministry. You hear me say it all the time right here. Don't get caught up in ministry. It's God, it's your family. Then you get on down to the ministry. Husbands are to love their wives first. Guys, just say that with me just a minute. I love my wife first. I thank you for the three that are saying that. On your wedding day, you made the following promise to your wife. You will have this woman to be your wife. Now, this may be not exactly what you said, but this is what I get out of my little book that when I do weddings. To live together with her in the covenant of marriage, you will love her, comfort her, honor and keep her in sickness and in health, and forsaking all others, be faithful to her as long as you both shall live. And you said, I will. And when you said, I will, you made a promise to God that you would do that. Husbands are to love their wives because the future of the church and the nation are at stake. Listen to me right here. As the family goes, so the nation goes. As the family has disintegrated somewhat, so is our nation disintegrating. The family is falling apart because men are not keeping their promise to their wives and to the Lord. Now, guys, I hate it that I'm putting it on you, but I'm just putting it on you. We have a promise that we've made. All right, parents, here's your chance. The next instruction is for the children. Listen to me, youth. Obey your parents. Paul says in chapter 6, he says, children, obey your parents because you belong to the Lord, and for this is the right thing to do. Now listen to me. What's amazing about the scripture is that Paul even addresses kids at all. You got to understand something. In this society, in this day and time, children were like women were treated then. They were looked upon as just property. They were not really even recognized as people for that recognition, so to say. They were just a piece of property. That's what they were. They belonged to the man, to the father. So for Paul to address children, he assumed that when this message would be preached, guess who would be in the room? Children. Why would he tell parents that? This was directly to the children. Children, obey your parents. So he had to assume this. Listen to me. One commentary said, by even addressing them, a segment of society that was considered to be virtually without rights, Paul elevated them and invested them with dignity and worth unheard of in the Roman world at that time. Beloved, he's trying to show you something. And kids, if you'll listen to me for just a minute, you'll understand. Paul has been given each person throughout these scriptures that I just read instructions to a happy family. Now, by telling them to obey, Paul says to obey on the basis basically of having paid attention to. Now, listen to this. What he's saying is not just to do what they tell you to do, but listen. Somebody say, listen, Linda. Listen. Listen to the advice that they give you. There are things that we learn from our kids, right? I learned stuff from my kids. But there are things that we will learn, that the children will learn from us. We learn things from our kids like enthusiasm when they're young. We go, man, I wish I had all that energy that they had. They have faith that is immeasurable. Their energy, it seems like it never goes away. But parents have a lot to teach you guys. And I know you don't think that. But we've been there and done that. Amen. Now, a lot of you in here probably have caught yourself saying, man, I remember when my dad or my mom said this. And then you sitting there spitting it out to your kid. And you go, man, I have become that person. There's wisdom in parents. I believe one day my kids are going to come to me and say, D, you was really a genius and we just didn't recognize it. You was a genius. I'm just telling you, we have to pay attention. I still today pay attention to my dad and my mom. I pay attention because there's wisdom in their years. And so I learn from that. Therefore, kids, you should be listening to your parents. Don't just think, well, they just saying it because they don't want me to go do this. No, they probably tell you because they done been down that road. And they're trying to save you some heartaches. Don't go over there to that house. I know what goes on over there. Well, how do you know? Because I used to go to one just like it. Don't get in the car with them people. I know what they're going to be doing. Why? Because I did the same thing. Proverbs 3, 1 and 2 says, my child, never forget the things I have taught you. Store my commands in your heart. If you do this, you will live many years and your life will be satisfying. Now, Paul tells them what to do. He tells them why they should do it. He gives them two reasons. Because you belong to the Lord, and it's the right thing to do. Now, when he says you belong to the Lord, what he's basically saying here is you are in Christ. Now, we know there's an age of accountability, and nobody knows that age. All right, there's nowhere in Scripture that gives that age. If you find it, you let me know, and I'll be standing corrected. The age of accountability that we always refer to, in my belief, is the age when a child understands. All right? So at that age, when someone is able to comprehend what is being taught, that's the age of accountability. Now, the Jews, we know that they did the bar mitzvahs or whatever and all that, like 12 and 13. So everybody goes, that's the age of accountability. I don't believe that. Some people reach maturity before other people do. All right? And so, therefore, the age of accountability is when we have a full understanding of what is being said to them. All right? He tells them to obey their parents because it's the right thing to do. Sometimes it's just a matter of the right thing because why? It's the right thing. You ever tell your kid to do something, you say, just do it. Why? Why I got to? Just do it. Because it's the right thing to do. Right? Don't slam your hand in the door. Why? Because it's going to hurt. Why? I just don't do it. And then finally you get aggravated, so you stick it in there, slam it in there for you. I would never do that, but some people do. For children whose parents, listen to me, are not followers of Jesus, when children still obey their parents, they are representing Jesus and don't even realize it. They're representing and don't even realize it. Paul then kicks it up a notch and he says this right here. Not only to obey your parents, but to honor your father and your mother. Now, this includes not only doing what they say when you are young, but continuing to listen to them as they get older. See, as we get older, then we think we don't have to listen to our parents anymore because now we know it all. Oh, yeah. I know. The past couple weeks, I've just been preaching myself. I understand. Some, though, include taking care of their parents. That's honoring to them. If your parents can't take care of themselves and you bring them in and you show them love and care, or maybe you're able to put them in a home or whatever it may be, that's honoring them. So just as Paul did for wives and husbands, he gives children how they benefit. Honor your father and mother. This is the first commandment with a promise. All right? With a promise. Listen to me, young people. If you honor your father and your mother, things will go well for you and you will have a long life on earth. It's a commandment with a promise. Of all the Ten Commandments, this is the only one that contains a promise with it. None of the other Ten Commandments have a promise. This is what we know is called a conditional clause in Scripture. In other words, if we do something, God does something. It's conditional. If you don't do it, children, guess what happens? You will not have a long life on earth. Things will not go well for you. So sometimes young people, when we feel like all hell's coming against us, we need to look at our relationship on how we're treating our parents. Man, I figured every parent here would have waved, shouted, danced or something. It's okay. If children honor their father and mother, God honors them in return, and the obedience brings blessing. Anytime you are obedient to the word of God, there's a blessing that follows it. Mm-hmm. Paul concludes by this right here, giving some more advice. He says, verse 4, fathers, do not provoke your children to anger by the way you treat them. Rather, bring them up with the discipline and instruction that comes from the Lord. In most cultures, the father takes the role of the disciplinary. All right? And in a lot of cultures, when dads get a hold of them youngins, it ain't good. All right? Paul is preaching actually against that. Listen to me. We are to discipline our children, but not to the point that they would turn against you. Do you understand that? So if you beat them down verbally, you can turn them against you. Do you hear me, dads? Even moms now. You can turn your child against you. And the Word of God says we're not to do that. We are to discipline our children the way that the Lord disciplines us. Firm, but with a gentle hand. Amen? Amen. Amen. I'm about done. Pastor Jennifer, you can come up if you want to. I want to read a poem that I read today. It's called Live Long and Prosper. It says, every generation blames the one before, and all of their frustrations come beating on your door. I know that I'm a prisoner to all my father held so dear. I know that I'm a hostage to all his hopes and fears. I just wish I could have told him in the living years. Crumbled bits of paper filled with imperfect thought, stilled conversations, I'm afraid that's all we've got. You say you just don't see it. He says it's perfect sense. You just can't get agreement in this present tense. We all talk a different language, talking in defense. Say it loud, say it clear. You can listen as well as you hear. It's too late when you die to admit we don't see eye to eye. So we open up a quarrel between the present and the past. We only sacrifice the future. It's the bitterness that lasts. So don't yield to the fortunes you sometimes see as fate. It may have a new perspective on a different day. And if you don't give up and don't give in, you may just be okay. I wasn't there that morning when my father passed away. I didn't get to tell him all the things I had to say. I think I called his spirit later that same year. I'm sure I heard his echo in my baby's newborn tears. I just wish I could have told him in the living years. If I went around this room tonight and asked how those words impacted you, I'm sure we would get different reactions. Many would say they have regrets. Don't let one of life's biggest regrets be that you never truly appreciated your parent. Parents won't always be around. Young people, listen to me. I know you hate your parents right now. But you got to love them because they're not always going to be here. We're not promised our next breath. And I say that not to bring you down, but I say that to say enjoy every moment that you have with them. It's all about love, honoring, and respect. It's about parents loving their children enough to teach them right from wrong, regardless what the world says is right. Right from wrong. Telling them what is right in the eyes of the Lord. All these things. It's about children respecting their parents enough to realize that they really do want the best for you. We don't tell you things because we want you to fail. We tell you things because we want to see you succeed. It's about accepting a responsibility. As parents, we need to realize that in teaching our children, we're shaping the future. While the world is like it is today, there's nobody to blame but parents. As children, we have to realize that we can learn from the past of our parents because we've already walked it. King Solomon said this, there's nothing new under the sun. It's just a different day that we're walking it. Amen. Beloved, I want you to understand something today. Like I said, we don't have it all together. But I know one reason we have it where we have it is because we put the Word of God in our life. And we honor it in our life, and we don't do it without it. Don't do it without it. We try to line up every way we can. Our kids don't like us sometimes. That's all right. When they get old enough, they'll understand one day when they got little knuckleheads running around. And we're trying to tell them, and they're going to catch themselves going, man, I remember my dad told me not to do that. And my dad did this, and my mom said this. You know, my wife says it all the time to our boys. She'll say, you know, y'all going to regret it one day. Take hold of it, because we don't know what tomorrow holds. Amen? Amen. Well, let me pray for you tonight, and I'll bless you and get you out of here. Got you out of here at 8:15.